Hello, in my previous lecture we discussed about planning. Today we will continue our discussion about the planning, and specifically we will talk about management by objectives. It is one of the established tools and practice which will help in achievement of the set goals and set plans. As we are seeing in the planning process, both long term and the short term plans are important. Plans are set based on the analysis of the data, analysis of the available information, and both futuristic based on the detailed assessment of the strengths, weaknesses, opportunities and threats. And once the plans are set, that is broken down to various objectives, and management by objectives, or in the short form what is called as the MBO, becomes another important tool in the hands of management. Let us spend time today in understanding the definition, concept, steps and advantages and limitations of MBO process. The management guru Peter Drucker has been given the credit of giving this term management by objectives. So specifically, at the end of this session, you must be able to define what this MBO is all about, know and understand the concept of MBO, define good objectives, describe good objectives, and know and understand the steps in establishing an MBO program, know and understand the advantages and limitations of MBO. MBO as a technique, as a practice, got widely accepted by the organizations world over in the mid 80s and continued to evolve in different forms. So, in the simplest of the form, MBO can be described as a technique and philosophy of management based on converting an organizational objective into a personal objective. Not only the conversion, but also it is based on the presumption that establishing personal objectives makes an employee committed and thus leads to a better performance. I think the word philosophy is very important when we look at and understand management by objectives. The technique is denied that once people know what the objectives are, once they have a clarity about the resources, they would be able to go and achieve these objectives. So this takes us to the philosophy of the McGregor's theory X and theory Y kind of assumptions about people. Theory X believed that basically people are lazy, people have to be driven, people have to be directed, people have to be chased to achieve the set goals. So the goal striving was considered as a kind of a compulsory activity, and it assumed that lazy people need to be motivated only through punishments, only through reprimands. Whereas you have the theory Y. Theory Y believes that people basically like their work, basically people would like to do and achieve the task, and the task achievement need to be enabled. Enabling would mean providing the required information, providing the required clarity, and helping them through proper assessment and reviews, making them move towards effective achievement of the set objectives. So the management by objectives, it is in that sense based on theory Y assumptions of the management, not really the theory X. So management by objectives is basically a process whereby the superior and subordinate managers of an enterprise jointly identify its common goals. So, the no doubt the strategic goals of the organization, the mission of the organization, vision of the organization and plans to achieve those things are stated at the organizational level. Now, this need to be viewed, need to be understood at different levels. What Likert talked about, the linking pin, he used the word linking pin, that every manager links the lower groups to the higher groups. So, management by objectives becomes an important tool for the role of the manager as a linking pin in the organization. So, they identify what are the common goals and it is done jointly and define each individual's major area of responsibility in terms of results expected of him and use these measures as guidelines for operating the unit or enterprise and assess the contribution of each of its members. So, the key word is this joint goal setting, joint action planning. Joint means, you know, together they understand the methods of assessing how they are moving towards the stated objectives and doing the joint review and coming to that kind of an appreciation of each other's role and contribution towards achievement of the plans itself. So, that is where the goals are jointly established by the manager and his subordinates and agreed upon in advance. So, the beginning of the planning period, the beginning of the period is very important. That is the time where they sit together, do the joint planning. And then as they go along, they do the joint review. And then at the end, they can make a joint assessment how far they have contributed, what is that they have done more, what is that they could have done better. So, these goals emphasize either output variables or intervening variables or some combination of both. So, we will understand the nature of these objectives itself and how these objectives comes into picture. So, the time is very important, the time frames are important. So, at the end of the predefined time means it could be half yearly or it could be yearly. And the subordinate performance is broken down in terms of set of expectations. These expectations are seen as objectives. So, in relation to the goals, these expectations are stated as objectives and the both boss and the subordinate sit together. They discuss the things in advance, how to go about it, they monitor and they review. I think that is the philosophy. So, participation is a key element. Both superior and the subordinates participate in this review and evaluation. So, it is advanced planning, there is an element of discussion, there is an agreement between the boss and the subordinate. That is, that too, the immediate boss and the immediate subordinate. And in the concept of theory Y philosophy, not the theory X philosophy of the McGregor, and the role played by the boss is of linking pin, understanding the activities at the lower level, setting the objectives, and then linking these objectives to overall divisional level objectives, divisional plans to the overall organizational plans. So, that is how the role of every manager becomes extremely critical in MBO kind of a process. So, after evaluation, it is found that there are some discrepancy. So, the discrepancy between the work planned and the work accomplished. So, the steps are suggested to overcome the problems or to make necessary adjustments in the original plan. That is how the role of the boss is no doubt clearly a controller, but he is also enabler. He also will have to play a role of a guide and a coach, informer. So, there are informational roles, there are decision roles as well as the controlling roles of the manager, particularly in the MBO process. MBO can also be an assessment procedure. MBO also can be a planning process. So that is how it is seen. MBO is an effective link between planning and its effective implementation. So it is in that sense, to conclude the definition and about the concept of MBO means managing by properly identifying the objectives of an organization. And this sets the stage to determine the objectives for the next time period or for the next level. And both boss and subordinate sit together, jointly negotiate, agree upon, and move towards the achievement of the stated purposes, which is also a totality of the organizational plan. So no objective can be seen which is not linked to the overall organizational plan. So objectives are not to be treated as good objective. So it could be the boss's plan, but boss's objectives is not self-fulfilling, but it is organizational fulfilling. That means it is meant to reach the goals, plans of the organization. So an objective is an intended goal which prescribes definite scope and suggests direction to the efforts of a manager. So the management is known for its performance. That is what I mentioned to you in the first lecture. It is production, productivity, value addition driven. So there is no role for management unless it is goal centric. It is there because it organizes the collective efforts to meet the goals of the system. So when you look at the manager, so it is to see how do you convert the talent into effort, and then effort should be linked to the performance. So objective is an intended goal, and it should help to provide what is to be done and what is not to be done. That is what we are talking about, the scope of the activities. It should help to prioritize what is required for the organization, and also provide that direction. It should suggest how to go about it to meet these. So let us look at these objectives in much more in detail. So it is the work in the same direction towards achieving company goals. People have different perceptions of the goal and the objectives. Let me give you an example. In one of the company, the goal is the number of machines they make and also the delivery. So what is delivery? Delivery need to be understood at all levels. So for a shop floor person, if he completes the task, he may think it is delivery, but certainly that is not delivery. Someone may think, no, he has completed the task, but we have also assembled and now we have put that in the finished goods store, and that can be seen as delivery, but that need not be the delivery. Someone may say, no, it has to be loaded to a truck and which should go out of the factory, that can be seen as delivery. For someone, no, that is not delivery, it should be moved to the customer's place, and customer should install that machinery and start using it, and that is delivery. For someone, that may not be the delivery. He should use it, and so that he should also write a check, and then the check should come back to the factory, and that is delivery. For someone, no, that's not delivery. The check should be deposited in the bank, and then the cash must be shown in the company's account, then it is delivery. So the question is, when you look at the objective, when you look at what this delivery is, it can mean many things at many levels to many people. And that is how an agreement between the objectives is very important. So what is that you are doing? Why are you doing? And what is that we are expecting at the end of the day? So, particularly with respect to the resources, with respect to the time, with respect to the quantity, with respect to the quality, with respect to the level with which you handle the thing, all are can be viewed as the scope of the activities. But the scope of the activities must be linked to the end results, and that is what we are calling as setting and achieving these objectives, and the process is called the management by objectives. So, the clearly defined and communicated to all such that it can be reasonably attained. So, everybody understands this, what these objectives are. I mentioned to you in the previous lecture the room occupancy rate. So, the room occupancy rate in a 5-star hotel could be based on a detailed analysis of various things. So, they may do many things. They may have a lobby set of stores, they may have a travel agency, they may have a restaurant, they have many things. But finally, they understand all these things are meant for what? All these things, how much give the value addition, which of the units make profits. So, when they do this kind of an analysis, they see many of the services what they provide in or the stores whatever is there or the restaurants, most of those things may not make any profit. But when they see if particular room is not occupied for a day, then that is a net loss to the hotel. So, that is where the room occupancy rate becomes very critical. So, once they understand that room occupancy rate is very critical, that everyone need to do to achieve that end objective of this room occupancy. So, 100% room occupancy is the best what can happen to that particular hotel. Once that is understood, then they want to look at various things what they want to do. So, that means the customer today, when he comes to the hotel, he would like to look at the same room, not only the same room, but he would like to have the same room boy. So, then now you will do many things, you work backwards and see how do you make the customer to ask for this room and this particular room boy. So, you are building that kind of a customer loyalty. Through the customer loyalty, you will achieve that the room occupancy as well. So, what I am trying to say is that organization tries to understand the end result in terms of a measurable, well articulated, clearly achievable goals, and these goals are stated in different levels, and each one can relate to the end objectives, and they do set of activities so that they can also relate these activities we are doing it so that the end objectives are clearly met. So, the clarity, the definitions and the communications are all becomes an extremely important thing, and that is how the good managers are known for their communication effectiveness. So, if they are able to clarify, if they are able to explain, if they are able to take the other fellow into confidence, build that required trust, and then enable them to see the objectives in different shades and making sure they do the required things what is wanted by the organization, then such managers can play a significant role in clarifying and defining objectives and also play a role in management by objectives. Another important thing when we are talking about objectives, it is not only the clarity, it is not only the communication, it is not only the definition, but the time frame is extremely important. These are the days of delivery. These are the days where people would like to have things at the right time and right place. Few days before or few minutes before, not wanted, and few minutes late, again not wanted. So, that is where the timeliness, wherever, whatever wanted at the right time, I think that's another important and a significant thing. So, the time period, once you stay, one can also make that kind of an adjustments. adjustments of how to build that required capacities, how to build that required systems and practices and the procedures so that it is made available at that time when it is wanted. So we will go back and see very clearly the nature of objectives itself. As we said, the objectives could mean many things at many levels and to many people within the organization. Certainly you have the short term and the long term thing. The expanding the work, lagging behind the schedule. So you want to see that you would like to speed up sort of task. So the speeding up of the task can come. So then the short term thing is that you would like to enhance the manpower. So you would like to hire some additional hands, or you would like to extend the time. If you are working normally for about 8 hours, you would like to do it for 10 hours. If you are doing it for 10 hours, you would like to do it for 12 hours. So you would like to see what is that we can stretch, what is that we can build some additional things, where is that we can bring that required flexibility to meet those short-term objectives. Similarly for the long-term thing. So the long-term things could involve the diversification. Long-term things is building certain capacities, certain competencies in certain areas. So it is in that sense, one can also see how do you achieve these long-term objectives. For example, in one company, they wanted to have a technical superiority in a particular area, but they could see they can do that only with the time lag of at least 6 to 8 years. So that means you have to hire that kind of a talent, invest in that kind of a talent, expose the talent and develop that required talent, and it takes about 6 to 8 years to build that capacity. So when you are seeing the long term, so hiring a set of people, maintaining them, developing them, these are all things will become objectives by themselves. So there is a long-term view of the organization, plans of the organization, but then you try and see in terms of X number of people to be hired, because there will be some attrition, some people will stay, some people will grow effectively. So you make such contingencies. So the plans, once it is stated, then you work out set of objectives around that, and those objectives need to be seen with respect to set of contingencies or the set of constraints, set of opportunities. And an MBO takes care of through a process of dialogue. The dialogue between the management, manager and his subordinate and his immediate subordinate, they understand, they discuss and jointly agree upon what best can be done, what best can be delivered. So that is where the nature of objectives also need to be very specific. If you put too many things, too general kinds of things, at the end of the day, you are not too sure. You are not too sure whether you have done the required things. So that is where the specific. So decision of pricing policies could be that, you know, how much of this cushion. I think you can go up to 2%, you can go up to 5%, either increase or decrease. These are very extremely specific kind of an indication based on the kind of margins available to the organization. And it can also be general, specific versus general, that overall keep the profitability. Okay, sometimes fair enough. You make a loss, but you are getting a customer. So it could be an entry strategy for you. So not necessarily every activity should generate a cash surplus. So the profit objective is extremely important. So increasing productivity is important. So then you will see with the overall things, how do you go about it. So it could be very general or it could be very specific. Again, it is important to draw how we try to define and describe the management evolution itself. We defined earlier, management is the art of getting things done through people. So people requires understanding, people require direction, and that is where the communication is important. The communication highly dependent upon the style of the boss, and that is how it is also seen. It is art of getting things done. And in a competitive economy, things will not be done unless everyone concerned in an enterprise knows what the objectives are, what the targets are. So they all work for that, the specific requirements of the organization. Each of the individual need to be aligned. So the alignment will come how? Alignment will come in terms of, if you see on the x-axis, it is basically it is the direction and the focus. Each member of the organization need to know what direction the organization is taking and to focus their activities very clearly on what is wanted by the organization. If you look at y-axis, then you know they need to have very clearly the required technologies, they need to have required attitudes, they need to have required skills, and they need to have required knowledge. But if you see only these two, on the x-axis the direction and the focus, and on the y-axis the technology, the attitudes, the skills and the knowledge. But there is a third dimension that is also equally important, that is rewards and punishments. How can you give rewards and punishments? The rewards and punishments can come about or through the goal achievements. How each one of them have put their effort, how is that they have achieved their goals, and towards that what is that to be done. So the rewards and punishment are the important reinforcers. So that is where the statement of the goals at the beginning is very important. Assessment of these goals is extremely critical, and doing this jointly is much more important because it is linked to the rewards and punishment. So the organizations today, they try and build this, because this, all the three systems on the x-axis and the y-axis and the third one built very clearly the alignment agenda. Let me elaborate some of these things later on as we go along. So clearly, if we need to spend a little more time on the types of objectives. If you will see, there are three types of objectives. What we are referring to sometimes when you are talking about at the strategic level or at the organization level as a whole, we are talking about the broad objectives, the future positions of the organization, the future views and vision of the organization, the mission of the organization. Then there are major objectives. Within that, for a few years, the cost becomes very important. We need to be focusing on the cost. In certain situations, the innovation becomes very critical. Sometimes the acquiring new customers become very critical. Sometimes the development of technologies become very critical. Sometimes the services which you provide, that becomes more critical. Sometimes the establishing infrastructure becomes more important. So the major objectives can vary in relation to the broad objectives, which can be 2 to 3 years, sometimes could be less than 2 years as well. Then the lesser objectives, please don't view this lesser objectives means not so important or not important or anything, but the lesser objectives to be understood with respect to when you start breaking down the major objectives at departmental level, at the individual levels. So that is where the broad or corporate objective is a wordy statement of the standing the company wishes to achieve. When we were discussing about the planning, we have said one could become a most preferred employer, one can be the having the highest market share, or it is he is the one who is releasing new products every time, or who is creating new benchmarks in terms of the service quality, or it could be the cost effective propositions. So it all depends. So but these are the broad objectives of an organization. So the broad objectives, some of the specific examples could be to supply to public with the best of modern utility services at reasonable rates. to manufacture high quality products and to strive to make them better at lower cost. So you will see, usually it is stated with respect to best at the low cost. So a quality versus the kind of positioning. So the broad objectives can be related to these major objectives. Major objectives are distilled from broad objective and set the tactical areas into which company wishes to move. And it could be seen the lesser objectives are targets, budgets and departmental objectives. It also includes those governing the performance standards of managers and the other members of the staff, particularly some of the values of the organization like teamwork or values of the organization in terms of the customer first or customer focus. So when you see the values of the organization and the requirements are coming in, so those things you will see as the performance standards of the managers and the members of the staff. So we will look at these things in relation to how do we go about in setting up an MBO program or an MBO process. Any MBO can also be seen as a major change initiative in the organization, as people are used to do things according to their convenience. MBO becomes a kind of a disciplined driven, transparency driven initiative. What do we mean by this? MBO becomes a top driven and also a strategy driven kind of a system. So the managers have to be understanding what is expected by the management, but that means their top managements, and then converting these top management desires into specific, achievable, measurable, specific things at lower levels, and that becomes the guiding thing. So the common goals and measures of performance need to be seen, and the first step is to clarify and set the common goals of the entire organization, and the next step is to see the organizational structure. To achieve these goals of the organization, you need to have an appropriate organizational structure with respect to different departments, with respect to different divisions, with respect to different roles, different responsibilities. So that is where the organizational structure need to be appropriate in order to meet the stated goals and plans of the organization. Unless you create appropriate departments, appropriate specializations, the goal cannot be broken down to the reasonable objectives. And once it is done, once you also have to see, sometimes you need to look at the titles of the people, the duties and the relationships, authorities and the responsibilities, and the span of control. So the organizational structure essentially is enabler to achieve the stated goals of the organization. So unless you have a very clear view of the plan, vision of the organization, and convert that into a set of objectives, but these objective setting need to be supported by the appropriate structure. The structure in terms of the required number of departments, number of levels, number of responsibilities, and the responsibilities going along with the authority. Certainly in my next lecture, we will see the required organization. We have defined the management functions in terms of planning, organizing. So when we see next step is to do the develop required organization to meet and enable the stated objectives. So the planning and organizing, they go hand in hand. But specifically coming to MBO, the setting goals, so the superior sets and they write down the goals and measures for subordinates. the subordinate also should have an equal responsibility, equal opportunity to propose the goals and measures, because sometimes he may would like to see. The time with which you are measuring is very important. Let us look at, for example, HRD, human resource development. It is not that kind of magic wand where you do one program at the end of the day, the individual becomes something different, something superior. So you need to see that you a good number of people, 20%, 30%, 40% of the people in the organizations are trained, and then you start seeing the effects. So the question is, when do you measure? Whether you measure at the beginning, or do you measure on how much money have you spent, or you will see what effect it has. So we started bringing this in terms of how do you measure. So the concept like causal, intervening and end result. So sometimes you can see budgetary kind of a thing, how much money you are going to spend, that becomes very critical. Sometimes it is what kind of, how many programs have you done because of this money. Sometimes with the same amount of budget support, you can do more number of programs, or you can do less number of programs. You can do short programs, you can do many, many, many programs with hourly basis. So how do you see this as utilization of the money? But it is not only the resources you have used. So some organizations use, I gave you this much money, what percentage of money have you used? That could be an evaluation thing, purely an input based, because you are not too sure of the intervening or the end result. Sometimes you don't bother about the input, but you look at the intervening thing is, how many you have done, how many people have participated, what is the reach out. So such measures one can deploy. But one can also look at the end result. The end result in terms of whether it has contributed to better coordination, better profits, or the better teamwork, so better behaviors. So many of these things which can be seen as the end result things. So when we set the objectives, are you setting at the input level, or at the intervening level, or at the end result level? So the subordinate can propose as the intervening, but the boss may be expecting at the end result. And that is where the setting goals becomes very critical. So both, that is the boss need to set, and also the subordinate need to propose. The boss also should propose and need to have a dialogue. So a two directional discussion are very, very important. A blind acceptance, a yes man behavior, or not having enough opportunities for participation and discussions are not very useful for MBO. We will see later on how some of the difficulties of MBO implementation will come. So usually the question comes, there are 5 to 6 vital areas where the subordinate concerned must think in order to obtain the desired result. So question comes is, should you sit together and discuss and set too many goals? So if you set too many goals in 10, 12, 15, 20, 30 areas, then it becomes too weak, too difficult to evaluate, to discuss anything in a focused way, it becomes extremely complex. So it is desirable, according to many managers, that you set goals, set objectives between 3 to 7 areas. So if you set more than 7 areas, it becomes highly complex, highly difficult. And if you are setting more than 7 up to 11, then it is too complex. And if you are setting more than 11, it is also suggested that you don't have to really set the objectives, because you can't understand, you cannot assess, you can't measure. So it is only the kind of a, so the desirability is the set these specific things between 3 to 7 areas. So as you see that once you define what are those areas, what are those critical concerns of the organization, and then you need to articulate those critical concerns. I used this word delivery earlier. Some organization use this word called the billable hours. All the time your activities must be coming around these billable hours. What are these billable hours? Means what is the customer would pay for. So in any activity what you do, there is, they have to do several things, but not all the things are paid by the customer. Customer would pay for some of these things which you do, and many things which you do in terms of preparation of doing those things are not accounted, not even cared for by the customer. So that means how many people you have deployed to achieve those things, not interested, but he is prepared to pay so many man hours for this activity. So that means you need to have that required number of people within the time frame, and whatever the customer is agreed to pay for, you need to achieve the task within that. So if you put more number of people, to that extent the kind of thing what you are going to get will get diluted. That means it affects your fund flow, it affects your profitability, it affects overall the effectiveness of the group and the organization. But once you use that billable hours, it is clear, one can understand, also one can now relate what is that activity which I can see as value add, what is that activity I can see it as core, what is that activity I need to do but nobody cares, nobody pays, and what is that I need not do. So you will, one should be able to see the activities, one should be able to clarify these things, and that is how the measures and the objectives help people to align their own individual agenda and the individual behavior. So the steps in setting up BO is very clear. So they may be driven by some targets of growth or achievements of greater efficiency, productivity or profitability, or elimination of certain problems. Elimination of certain problems is number of breakdowns, what is happening, or number of field visits one is making to see that the machine is running at the customer site. So if it is a breakdown, frequent breakdowns, then it is difficult to attend to. Also it costs more money. All the rework need to be avoided. So it is in that sense the goals can be set, the objectives are can be set with respect to all these things. It could be in terms of the percentages, it could be in terms of the numbers, or it could be in terms of the absolute things what one is looking at. I did mention earlier the joint agreement on subordinate, the goals what bosses would agree upon. So it is the basically you have to have a document which is written out at the beginning of the period, quarterly, half yearly or yearly. So they sit together, discuss these objectives, reach an agreement on subordinates goals to be achieved and during the stated time period. All the things are important. That means at the end of the details. So that means you will give the title of position, you will state this is the time period within which we have agreed to do these things, and then clearly stated objectives. But finally the boss and subordinate have to state, yes, we have discussed this, we have understood, and also expect these are the kind of a contingencies, but all that constraints and the contingencies taking into consideration, we have reviewed the objectives and these are the things expected. So such kind of an agreement requires good amount of time and a quality time between the boss and the subordinate. So many also call this as a kind of a paperwork jungle. So that means you are creating lot of documents and lot of papers between the boss and the subordinate. And now you will also see the knockout of inappropriate goals. Sometimes the individual would like to go through a set of training programs. Then you may say it is not an important thing, it may not bring any value. So I don't think I would like to support. So that is the boss can relate and react to it. And the individual also can be stating that these things are I'm focusing on and I cannot take these things because I don't see any value add. So they can knock out many of the inappropriate or activities which will not bring any focused measurable actions towards achievement of the overall goals of the organization. So throughout the time period, what is to be accomplished should be compared with what is being accomplished, and necessary adjustments should be made, and the inappropriate goals must be discarded. So focusing, refocusing, renewing, and reminding, I think these are all the steps of this knocking out of certain objectives of the part of this MBO process. As we go along, we will also see the cumulative periodic review of subordinates' results against the targets. All the subordinates will need to see against their MBO plan. They must be formally reviewed at predetermined times during the plan. So not only it is advanced planning, it is not only the planning of an understanding of the objectives, but also there must be a different time periods, and then sitting together, understanding how well we have done, how more we can do, how better we can do the things, what is that we should have done, what is that we need not do. Clarifying these roles and responsibilities become extremely important. Let me restate this particular point. Understanding. Towards understanding, communication. Good trust between the boss and the subordinate, because you believe that person can understand. So that is where the theory why kind of an approach of the manager, and then putting that effort together to meet that. I think unless these philosophy driven, transparent approaches driven, and believing and developing the subordinates, many of these things become extremely critical, extremely important. And the concern for time. So when you see all this, the advantages could be many. Both theoretically you will see, it is a very, very powerful tool in gaining mutual commitment and high productivity for an organization, because you are able to link from the top to the bottom through the process of this linking pin. Each of the managers, they do their task in relation to what is wanted by the organization, what is wanted by the top management, and then clarify and create required expectations to their lower levels, and similarly it is passed down to the lowest level possible. So the MBO keeps the company objectives and the targets constantly in view. Every activity can be linked to the end results. Every action is aligned, focused. It is focused and aligned based on the attitudes, the capacities, and the knowledge of the individuals. And most of the time, the achievement of the targets is also linked to the rewards and punishments. And that is how you see it builds a performing organization. So evolving performing organization through people, MBO is a kind of a method. It's a method of tool, and then you also see it becomes a kind of a process. It becomes a technique, and how you see that becomes very critical. It gives meaning and direction to the people in the organization, and coordinates. Particularly, we have seen one of the critical functions of the manager is coordination, planning, organizing, and coordination and controlling. So the functions of management, you will see the efforts of various departments of an organization now can be related to the overall requirements of the organization, because it's a top-down approach where you start with organizational plans, then you break that into many divisionalized departmental level goals and the objectives. People also get motivated because now there is clarity. It is very clear. You can also put required effort to achieve those stated objectives, and it gives that required visibility. It reinforces, because the achievement of goals itself is a great motivator. So the achievement brings that extra energy in the individuals, and that is how it is also seen. It motivates. It motivates at different levels, and the person is very clear what is that he stated and what is that he has done towards achieving those things. It also prevents frittering away of efforts and money. So sometimes you know the waste of resources. You see why you have brought certain machinery, why you have brought certain gadgets. Many people don't understand because it is not linked to the productivity. It is not linked to what is required. So because something available, you can't buy. Because now in a management by objectives, you are very clear why are you committing resources. Because you commit these resources to do set of things. And the set of things, not just it is nice to do, it is required by the organization. And that is how it becomes much more useful and relevant in terms of budgeting, in terms of committing resources of the organization. Allows greater consistency in decision making. So there is a kind of a principle things. When you make other person accountable, it is data based. It is mutual. It is based on the respect. It is based on a principle of transparency. And that is how you see there is a, it becomes consistent. And wherever the deviations are there, you also know how to respond to the individuals and correct. In a non-MBO mode, most of the managers find it difficult to tell the other person. They are not easy to communicate, particularly in a failure mode, because you have not agreed upon anything. But when you have agreed upon set of actions, and you also know why some of these things to be done, it is easy to have a good, meaningful dialogue. So forces management to think ahead with respect to its short-term and long-term goals. Unless there is a pre-thinking is done. You remember in my last lecture, I did talk about planning as an intellectual exercise. So the intellectual exercise is that you do have information, you do have data, you also do the analysis, and then link this analysis to generate different courses of action. You do good brainstorming, and based on that you accept the future positions of the organization and also various steps to achieve those future positions. And now, having agreed upon that future positions and the steps, now you come back and ask each of the managers, look, these are our divisional requirements, these are departmental requirements, and how do we achieve these things, and so that it provides a basis for that kind of a meaningful dialogue. So that is where the thinking ahead of the short term and long terms, it strengthens that whole process. Also helps to an enterprise, as I said earlier, to focus on areas where it is vital that the management should be effective and isolate the problems preventing the progress towards the company's objectives. So very clearly now you know what is important and what is trivial. What is now and what can be done later. What is that you can't compromise. What is that you can. So these things become very clear in a management by objectives kind of a situation. So the advantages, as we are seeing, it contributes for better leadership. Leads to a better understanding between supervisors and the subordinates. The subordinates, they see the bosses as clear communicators. They look at them as linking their efforts, their contribution to the overall requirements of the organization. And they also perceive the role of the leaders as enablers, the role of their immediate bosses as very clearly the one who would control based on facts and figures, not on the perceptions, not on whims and fancies. But we should also see all is not hunky-dory, all is not great about MBO. As we have talked about this MBO and the scope of the activities, many have also criticized that MBO is not a panacea, MBO is not a magic wand, MBO cannot solve all the problems of the organization. It cannot solve the problems of the organization if it is driven by poor planning, if it is not driven by true philosophy of typically theory Y kind of management, if there is no transparency, if there is no clarity at the highest level, it cannot bring clarity, involvement, participation, commitment at the lower level. That is how MBO also has been criticized, and MBO also has failed in many organizations because change is not managed properly, it is not implemented properly, or it is implemented with only good things in mind and expecting that great and lots of things will happen initially, but a disappointment sets in because they get involved in a paperwork jungle. And that is how you see, if it becomes too rigid, a pattern of thinking and action, it is then it becomes very, very unsuccessful. That means only you have to sit, write down the objectives, and then you have to, at the end of the period, you have to review it, and then if it becomes an annual ritual of form filling activity, then the MBO fails for sure. So many critics of MBO, they say it ends up in paperwork, it ends up in a time consuming, ritualistic kind of a dialogue between the management and the subordinates. That is a sure way of killing any MBO program. And always there is a need for flexibility in management thinking, more so if you see in a fast changing kind of an environment. Then normally what happens? The people change from one group to the other. They move from one function to the other, from one department to the other. So the subordinate and the boss linkages are not so permanent, are not so semi-permanent. Where people change the groups from, particularly in a project mode kind of an organization, also fast expanding kind of an organization, suddenly MBO fails because the documented details, the context and the scenario changes as the individuals move, as the individuals take up different roles and responsibilities. And you need to design systems and practices which will also go well with the required flexibility. The provision of written objectives should not be allowed to affect this adversely, because sometimes even though when there is a scope of action, people work at the punishment avoidance level. I think that's where our understanding of all these things are important. That is, MBO is an important tool. We have discussed the definition and concept of MBO. We have also looked at the definition and types of MBO. We have seen various steps involved in setting up of an MBO program and recognized the advantages and limitations of MBO program. And certainly, a good planning process and good program of achieving the objectives will strengthen effective management process. In my next lecture, we will look at about organizing and how do we create an effective and a performing organization.